It is 2:31. We're going to call to order. Please rise for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please.
Mrs. Dubay?
Present.
Mrs. Hilton? Mr. Hubler?
Present.
Mr. Lipsky?
Here.
Mrs. Ross is here. Mrs. Serviel?
Here.
Dr. Spencer?
Here.
Six.
Thank you. Is there any hearing of school district patrons?
No, ma'am.
Wonderful. Presentations?
We have summer work being presented by Mr. Chofsky.
Put him on the clock.
Put him on the clock.
All right, you got 10 minutes.
All right, 10 minutes. Here we roll. All right.
Now we're good.
Here. Now we're good.
Only because of Steve.
Only because of Steve.
Put him on the clock.
Hold on.
She messed up.
Being a gentleman.
There we go.
My apologies for my bad haircut.
It looks amazing.
They want to see the other side.
It looks fantastic.
Great.
A little bit too much wine last night, I think. What I'd like to do is, first of all, please, I appreciate the opportunity to speak to all of you about our department, especially the maintenance grounds and custodians. What I have found out is that they're very hardworking, very caring. We're moving annual training all the time with a focus on technology. What I mean by a focus on technology is that the majority of our HVAC systems now are all control modules. So it's getting more and more tech-driven. Collaboration, when we come together as groups, we do big projects together. For example, if they want to put in a condenser or work on an HVAC unit, we're doing that together. You know, teaching and training. And trying to be efficient and effective on all of our projects. Another project that we're looking at is Robustall, redoing the approaches. And we talked to the county, and we think that we can do this work ourselves. It can save us, a significant amount of money. Focus, maintenance grounds, custodians, for annual inspections, as well as annual summer work. So maintenance, preventive maintenance and general maintenance, 9 elementary schools, 4 middle, 2 high schools, performing arts center, 2 child care centers, Pellerin, support services, and the Wheeler building. Our maintenance group, we now have a full staff. Basically, some of the big issues that we deal with during the summer are with our unit ventilators and the rooftop units. Routine maintenance on our boilers, maintain all of the controls for HVAC. And what I mean by maintain is that every single time that we turn it on, it's showing the temperature that we're looking for. So, and if there's a problem, we're bringing, sometimes contractors out there, and we're looking at it and making sure that we're right on with all of these buildings. The completion of all of our work orders, we're looking at checking and repairing all of our refrigeration, the completing plumbing issues, mechanical, electrical repairs, general maintenance on all of our roofing, which this summer we found out we've got some issues that we have to do. So again, these are things that we can find out now that we probably can't do during the winter months. The other piece is trying to improve energy savings. Again, working on our controls so that our timers, our lights are adjusted so that we're not paying for these lights to be on at inopportune times. Oops, I'm sorry. Grounds. I'm sure everyone knows this. The grounds are around all of our district buildings, 18 baseball fields, 14 football fields, and the associated tracks, 4 soccer fields, 16 tennis courts, 4 outdoor basketball courts, 16 tennis courts. What we'll do is we will try to fix any of those cracks that we have at the 2 high schools and make sure that they're up and running for the fall. Restriping of parking lots. Our guys come together, 5 or 6 of them, and they work hard for 2 to 3 days and knock a building out. So we'll go over to Middle School South, I believe, this year. Wheeler High School, the high school, and High School North for certain. We repair all the play pads at the elementary schools, maintain the grass, weeds, and fertilizing, maintain the baseball, softball diamonds. We look to reseal the parking lots to save some money so that we can get that done so that we don't have cracks that become bigger cracks. We seal paint the tennis courts at both high schools, maintain and repair the approaches to the schools if we need them, and remove and replace trees. The grounds, we identify any type of safety issues around our buildings, maintain and operate the irrigation systems. We update and paint the games in the play areas of the elementary schools. We transport the scissor lift throughout the district for, you know, to complete lighting projects or painting projects. And then the grounds also repair and maintain their own equipment. Custodians. 2 big swimming pools, 22 gymnasiums, 160 individual restrooms for elementary, 22 gang restrooms, 17 childcare rooms, 189 elementary rooms, 201 middle schools classrooms, 354 high school classrooms, 18 locker rooms, and 140 hallways. So it's a vast, you know, and a very difficult challenge sometimes to get everything done. So again, we have some very, in my opinion, some very, very high caliber people that, you know, get the job done. They replace the stained tiling, the stained ceiling tiles. They replace burnout lighting, clean the air vent, all of the air vents, and change the filters, clean and wash walls, vacuum carpet, and remove the stains. Wash floor tile, apply all of the coats of finish, and then they clean the furniture and make the repairs as needed. Clean windows inside and out, ensure all the lockers are clean. Again, they help change the filters as well. They paint classrooms. I think right now this summer we are doing a big improvement project at South River. They repair the drywall as well. We maintain the grass around the buildings. The custodians are there inside of the sidewalk, and they clean all bathrooms. Inspections, which is obviously is a huge part of our job in the summer, because it's a time when we can get all of these inspections done. Elevators are inspected, fire alarm testing, fire and kitchen suppression systems, fire extinguishers, the water backflow prevention, boiler inspections, the AED annual testing, so that we make sure that all those machines actually work, and then the bleacher inspections at the indoor and outdoor fields. Big job for us this summer is we finished gym floors. That's a huge job that we've got to do in all of our buildings. They clean grease traps, clean the kitchen hoods, repair storm drains, which we had a couple situations with this summer, and we utilized the scissor lift for lighting, cleaning, and etc. If there's any questions, I'd be more than happy to answer them or expound on them. But for the most part, I think they're working very hard. I think for a couple weeks we'll have some staff out, and we'll be filling in and things of that nature. But we're here all summer, and the staff's up there working hard. Is there anything I can help with? Yes, sir.
Oh, there's a couple things. I go basic. First of all, you said there that some of our crews they're considering rebuilding egresses, like parking access to parking lots, driveways, etc.?
Not repairing, just, I'm sorry, repairing, yes, not replacing.
Okay, so cement work, etc.?
It's not cement, it will just be asphalt.
Okay, good.
Replacing, yes, sir.
Okay. And then you talked about, I mean, you have a lot of staff dedicated. The idea of energy savings, I mean, the inventory you have is huge. And with all the different buildings and the different methods of, and different energy savings, how do you, we had a company come in and consult about 5 years ago. We took some action on there. We incorporated a number of those things. How do they keep up on monitoring energy costs and potential savings?
Well, I think the number one issue is, and I haven't been here long enough to really figure out, but one of the biggest issues is to make sure that these lights throughout our buildings are turned off at the appropriate time, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we're probably spending a lot of money that we shouldn't be spending because the timers are off. So again, this is a control module issue that our staff has, it's becoming our number one focus.
And when they first put the motion sensors in, they were a little too sensitive. They were going off, in the middle of the class. So, I mean,
LED lights, those.
Yeah, but without a doubt, one of our greatest potential cost savings is efficient energy.
Absolutely. And then how, purchasing that as well.
Cool.
Just a note that the middle school, because it's in my backyard, middle school central. Mm-hmm. For some reason, one night at about midnight, a light went on inside the school, and it was on until about 2 o'clock in the morning, and then it went off. Like somebody was in, a light went on, somebody was in there, and then it went off. I don't know, I can't remember the date.
Okay.
But
what were you doing up that late?
We're
retired. A light blinded her.
What were you staring at a light for 2 hours?
No, I was just kept walking through
Steve,
the kitchen.
Turn a different one on next week. Sorry, you forgot. That is.
But anyhow, it was strange, and whether a sense of
sensor.
We had a mouse that ran through the building and turned on the lights.
Some motion of some sort.
Right.
Life. Any other questions for Steve from the board?
You said no cement work this summer?
Well,
there is going to be some cement work, but it's more related to the storm drains.
So we'll be approaching that when we talk about the purchase order in regards to the storm drains.
Absolutely.
And one of them was at South River?
Yes, sir.
And that can't be more than 12, 15 years old. That gives me some concern.
Mm-hmm. They give me some concern as well, sir. I'll be honest.
Just to make note.
Yes, ma'am.
And it probably will not affect you, but there was a house being built on Hall Road. It was being refurbished, and they put up a garage. They put up a garage, and it went right on cement. No, right on the drain that comes from high school to middle school to the sewers.
Yes, ma'am.
Hall Road and what?
On Hall Road. The people.
Yeah, but Hall and what? Hall Road and what?
Hall and Heinrich?
No. It's Town Hall, and
oh,
it's
town.
Right
town
across.
Hall.
Gotcha.
Town Hall, and it's right across from the, not too far from the
high school.
I can't think of it. The Town Hall.
Middle
school. The building.
Oh, the actual. So that stinks.
The drain comes from the high school, the middle school.
You mean the real Town Hall.
Right.
And it goes right through. And this is stop work, and they're investigating. But the platform for the garage is sitting right on top of the storm drain.
The drain happened
to the sewer.
Who checked that out before they signed off on that?
Well, they're ready to start moving. Just so he knows.
Wow.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Thank you.
Hey.
Terry.
Okay, so this, when you talked about the fields and so forth, could you speak to the relationship between what kinds of repair and upkeep that is done related to the launch crews Little League versus the district? Because when my husband was really highly involved in that, some of the fields were in terrible, there were terrible things wrong with them, and then safety issues. So they tried to do whatever they could, but they got word that, hey, look, it, this is our, you know, this is our job to repair.
On the south end of town?
Yeah. Like the, I'm pretty sure the one of them was the field that's by middle school and the
preschool. School central.
In
is it the middle school central?
Yeah.
So our booster club last year made that field more level.
Okay.
Put bases in for softball and baseball. So okay. That was done last year by the athletic
club. Oh, and so then that's later than what I...
That's exactly right. I want to say it was last year, maybe a year and a half ago.
I'll comment on that too. That was an ongoing growing problem at both ends of the district. And yeah. Steve spent a fair amount of time working with them this year, met with the leaders of all those groups of people, talked about things that they wanted to see, obviously working within our constraints, but there's a open relationship and we've been working on those things pretty
well. That's good, because there were people and primarily men in the community that had time and had the inclination to to provide labor and help, and yet it seemed like it was just being, you know, not capitalized on, and not, there was no like partnership, or it seemed
definitely
like everything was falling on deaf ears.
I
and
understand.
I just wanted to know, since he talked about the fields and what's being done with the fields, I just wanted to find out, is that still the case that nobody other than our people can do anything to help?
Traditionally, they maintain,
because of union.
You know, our staff maintains the fields, but I'm certain that there are parents and volunteers within those organizations that work very closely with our, I know they've worked with me too.
Okay.
So I mean, on the north end, I think I've talked to some of the gentlemen on the south end as well.
Yeah.
But it's,
there's not a prohibition against that, Terry.
Okay.
We're working together.
Not at all.
Okay, that's good.
I mean, if there was something in the past, I just wasn't aware of it. But I, you know, in the future, I'm willing to work with all the organizations.
Yeah, because the impression that was given was, hey, you know, our people are union and you can't do anything because then, but then they say, well, then why isn't it being done? And whatever.
Yeah, that circular argument's kind
okay.
of. And,
I'm certainly with
we're not there all the way yet, but it's been much better year this year than last year.
Thank you.
There's, I'm looking at a text message from the Little League.
Yeah.
They asked coaches and some of the parents, there's stuff going on tomorrow at Trombley. Painting, there's a pitching tunnel, there's backstops are being painted, stuff like that. But the Little League sends out these kinds of text messages probably once every 3 months of some sort of help from the coaches or whatever to go do stuff.
Good.
Talking about building dugouts and things like that.
Yeah.
But do they need permission for
that? Yeah, I hope so. They should be able to do what they want.
We know.
Let's have the superintendent.
Yeah, we know about it if they
okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
They do need permission to do it, but we've opened the communication directly from Steve.
Well, sure, if they want to.
So they have his cell phone number. He tries to protect his cell phone number, but I mean, they have
it.
Is it
really Steve or is it the athletic director?
It's Steve.
Okay, because at some point it was...
No, it's Steve now.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
But we have an open line.
Well, that's great. It sounds like things have changed a lot, so I just wanted to check.
It was, you know, I was a little bit under the weather for about three or four weeks, but after that we were able to...
So as a point person now, if somebody
and
makes
up... I just generally communicate with myself.
Okay.
Well, I was gone. The grounds guys were out
yeah.
helping some groups too, so
I have to say that people have told me that it's far better, so whatever that means, I don't know.
From what I've seen, the fields, I've been to our middle school, but I've been over by Yaks, and those fields look nice. I mean,
they
look better than they used to look.
Good. Oh yeah,
every day we just get better.
Yeah, good. Thank you.
Any other questions for Steve? Thank you so much.
Thank you
for coming in and sharing with us. Superintendent?
Thank you. I sent an email attached again on the Friday update this week, and I've sent it to you previously about a month and a half ago. It's the same piece of information. There was a request to... There's information on there that I would not spend time on unless there's questions regarded to previous sales of buildings that have taken place over the last 18 months or so. But I do want some reflection on two pieces of property, one which is still currently for sale and one is not for sale, but could be offered for sale. So the first is the discussion on the Jefferson building. About the last time I did a communication on this, I sent several comps. I've had lengthy conversations with the realtor on this situation. There have been a lot of views on this property. There have been several visits to the property. All of them have been builders of one sort of or another interested in residential building. Again, not sure. Again, there's a triple step process in building on that site at Jefferson. One is agreeing to a purchase price with the district. Two is agreeing to something with the planning commission. And then three is actually getting the site approved for the structures they want to build. So at this point, we're only dealing with phase one, but we have not had legitimate offers. When Amy was president, we got an offer that was extremely low on the property that actually we didn't even bring to the board because it was like $120,000 or something like that. Other than that, we have had lots of interest, but no one willing to take a bite. The data is there, in my opinion, to look at price on this issue from recommendation of the realtor. It's not costing us any money to leave it at the price it's listed right now, which is $459,000. It's not costing us anything. We could leave it there indefinitely and continue to see what happens. I don't understand enough about commercial real estate to know when people are willing to bid and when they're not willing to bid based on the current offering price. There is a sale there somewhere. There's definitely a sale there somewhere. I don't believe, it will be vacant forever. But the realtor is recommending a significant lowering of price to $295,000. We obviously don't need to do that. We can counter with whatever we want, but the board sets parameters for the selling of property, so I'm bringing it to you now. It's been sitting there for quite a long period of time. That's issue number one. Issue number two, I believe that's one that we need to act on or do something or think about at least, because that's currently for sale. At the end of Painkill Boulevard, there's a large piece of property behind the Auto Tech Center, between our Auto Tech Center and the highway. We own a large amount of that. Besides, there's some easements and other things around. But
is that where the billboard is?
It is, yes, yeah. Between our end of our parking lot and the billboard. As you know, a year ago, a little over a year ago, we got an offer to purchase that property, and it was not for sale. The board did not ask to put it for sale, so it was not for sale. And it was a nice offer to build on that property from a business that would back up to it on Capitol.
Right.
So Capitol's the drive directly to the south of us here. They would access, their primary access to that would be from their own Capitol Drive. They could build, basically build on the rear of their building. I think I'm pointing in the right direction. Mm-hmm. And then they would build it in the rear of their building, and then they want to expand their company, and it was a very positive thing. The deal fell through. Rather spectacularly, when they found it out, they wanted to put in secondary access, which would have required not only additional negotiating from us, because secondary access was code for somewhere along our property to give them a secondary access, but also they got a very high amount of the engineering costs for that came in incredibly high, several million dollars to build something along perhaps on the back end of JPEG on this side and going along the property line that way that would not be used very often but for some sort of secondary access, emergencies, and other things of that nature. I think they had some other internal struggles and which we weren't aware of all those details. So there's still some open question as to whether we wanted to try to sell that piece of property or not. I'm kind of here on this one, okay? I'll be honest with you. I do believe we have room to add on to Painkill if that's ever the desire and ever that's a financial decision of the board if we wanted to add on to Painkill on this side. So in other words, connecting the side of the building where the horticulture room is over towards the construction trades building. There's a fairly large amount of land there. There's room that would not be impacted if we were to sell this piece of property. However, it is our only piece of property contiguous to a school that we have left. It's our only large piece of property we have left, and it's bordering our own, meaningful. We have a little tiny piece next to Middle School South that's semi-underwater most of the year. So that, and it would be some sort of light usage property that I was advised that would be, like mini storage, which is a very popular thing to build right now. And other types of things like that. It would not be industrial. Some sort of light business that does not need a lot of exposure, street exposure, because you would not have a lot of street exposure to that. there's no way the road commission or the state's going to allow access from the highway side. That's already kind of been explored by a couple of people, and we looked into that. That's not going to be a way. So they would have to, in order to sell it, we'd have to give them access to Panko Boulevard. That's the short answer. So we can control it, we could gate it, we could make it locked so they couldn't, so we wouldn't have kids going over there, things like that. But Mini Storage is 24 hours a day. It's off on our property, off of our property, type of thing like that. So I don't know how the board feels about that. Listing price of that could be around $700,000 for that parcel of property.
How big is the place?
It is.
I didn't bring that stuff with me.
Was it 8 acres?
Yes, it's 7.5, I think. So those are the two items up. If the board wants to discuss or doesn't want to discuss, absent discussion, that doesn't go for sale, and Jefferson stays at 459. Other than that, I'm looking for some, if there's any further direction on that.
Sharon?
I have been thinking all along, because of where it is, what it is, and what we'd have to give up to, like that, I don't want anyone doing that on our property, but
right.
I just kind of remember Atwood. You know, this is the last piece we have here.
Right.
We could add on to Panko. I've been thinking about that for a while, too, if we reach that point. Money is one thing, and could we use some? Yes. But I think a little bit more long-term, personally, I think it's a better idea not to do anything with that. Leave it for us. I don't want people coming up and down
right.
Panko. I don't want that access thing and all that sort of thing. And then I don't want us to find, oh, we're ready to expand, and, oh, no, we sold that piece
right.
of property because it's the last thing we've got here. And I think our next place of potential expansion would be some of the stuff at Panko. And
right.
you know what, seriously, that Jefferson property is just like just sort of sticks in my craw because I understand like this is the current acreage, you know, price.
Mm-hmm.
But I also understand where that piece of property is and what it opens up to. And I'm telling you, there's way more value in that. And unless it's costing us an arm and a leg for taxes every year to clean everything
no.
else up. My feeling is just sit on it for a little while.
Yeah. We will reach that limit at some point.
Yes.
But it's several years.
Yes, it's not now.
No, we
right.
still hold tax-free status on it as the owner of it as a school
so
district.
So that's Sharon's 2 cents on both pieces.
Terry? I would agree with Sharon, and I would not be in tune at this time with lowering any price.
Okay.
In fact, I think it's low enough.
Yeah.
But, and especially because of the season it's in, and especially because
mm-hmm.
the market is on the hot side. It's about the right person seeing it
right.
and wanting to buy it. So I don't know that it's the price as it is just the right person hasn't seen it. Or so I don't know. What's the marketing of that property commercially? Where is it being marketed?
There's a large commercial real estate database that's used. It's similar to the MLS. It's on the MLS, the residential side as well.
Okay.
It's advertised via their commercial sites. I mean, there's probably 3 or 4 commercial, big-time commercial people in the
yeah.
Cone County, so they
yeah.
kind of circulate deals with each other, to be
okay.
honest with you.
Yeah. Jen? I forgot to ask, too, is there still trailers in that trailer park, right?
At Blue Sky, yes, there are.
So what is the terminal date for?
Indefinite.
Oh, I thought they had a terminal date.
I don't believe so. I think he owns that property outright at this point.
Oh, okay.
It's
yeah.
all. It's almost all rentals.
More.
Well, yeah, because
yeah,
he's sitting in an
it's
even
a desirable
better sweet
piece
spot
of property.
Than we are. Yeah,
it's a similar
for sure.
It's not that
I thought there was a terminal date for them to come out, though, so that would have changed.
I can check that, but I don't.
That is like prime real estate
oh,
for
God,
a hotel.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. A
or
hotel.
Anything.
Hotel, a big
yeah.
destination
yeah.
hotel. But
especially if we're in the
there
middle
was
of
one going to be built one, and it didn't happen. So
My question. How much have we spent on the Jefferson property?
Besides the teardown costs that were incurred originally and the fact that we cut it, we maintain it, other than that, no cost.
No. What was that original
oh.
cost?
I just had
it
like $200.
I thought it was $250, was it?
Something
yeah,
like
something around $250
or something?
Yeah. Demolition.
Close to $250.
We spent on the property, yeah.
Yes.
We have spent $244,800.
Okay, so is everybody comfortable if I round that up to $250?
Sure.
Mm-hmm. So I would not feel comfortable taking it down to $295 because we already have $250 in it.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
But I do think that maybe to get it to move, if we rearrange the price a little bit, but not coming down that dramatic. If we came down to maybe $399 or came down to $425 or something like that, I would like to see if the real estate agents might be able to get
okay.
us numbers like that.
maybe a change in, a slight change in the price might help make it move, draw attention to it.
Or maybe just explore it and wait at least through, I don't know, through August.
Right. I agree.
I don't think there's any urgency. But
I agree.
So here's another thing I could
do. Once things really cool down, then maybe...
I agree, but I'm not in favor of the $295 either, being that we have $250 in it. So, and the PayCal property, I don't feel comfortable having people on our property either.
And that's,
I don't feel comfortable having being 24 hours.
I have to tell you, when I first thought about that, it was the Capital Drive piece work because we were accessing it from their own property. It was really the ideal purchaser, but having thought about it more with a different buyer, we lose a lot of flexibility with that.
Mm-hmm. They trash our road, then we get to fix it.
It's a private road, isn't it? It's own, not
only we own the
county.
Road. That's correct. Yes, based on all the power work we've done, we surely
own that road.
Yeah.
All right, any other discussion?
No.
Okay, I'll continue updating that. I'll let him know that there's no formal lowering, but if he engages in discussions that sound promising, then I'll bring them back to you on the Jefferson property and not put Panko for sale.
I will say, I agree with Terry, though. I think we run it through the summer.
Okay.
Let that real estate cycle go through, and then we can decide on a slight change just to bring maybe some more marketing action to it.
Sounds
fine. Because if it's like the MLS,
but
any change alerts everyone that ever was interested in it.
Right.
They
get
notice of it.
Right.
So.
Got a Hall of Distinction?
Yes, thank you. We have, the packets were included, but there's a joint, but there's three people, but it's two different nominations. One is for Ann Hart and Emma Jangelis together as the creators of the community service system in Las Creuse, which is quite common with schools nowadays, but was very revolutionary when this occurred many, many years ago. And they had a committee that was formed. It's the same process that's being followed that was followed with the other people. There's no cost incurred to the district. Asking for a nomination later in the meeting to approve that they be inducted in. The committee was formed. Had Laura, Mike, Tanya, Kevin Blum, John DeVia, Diane Lobestall on the committee. And highly recommend them. And scores are attached. The second is on Pauline Pavlik, who was a much longer ago employee, but as you remember or may know, the boat outing is named after her. She worked as someone who was a parent, a board member, and then an employee of the district. She was heavy into grants, and when we had we had more than one person working on grants in the district at the time separately. She brought a lot of different things into the district as far as grants. She was big in the middle school concept as well. She worked a lot with Mr. Dooley and Mr. DeVia on developing the middle school concept in Las Creuse. So she is deceased and has been for some time, but a nomination to elect her to the Hall of Distinction as well as a separate nomination.
Huh. Any discussion?
That's a good idea.
No? All right. Curriculum and instruction, student travel requests.
We have our student travel requests. One of them coming up later this summer. One from Panko, three from Middle School Central, and one from Middle School State. All meet the required criteria and look in order unless any questions.
I have one comment.
Yes, Chair.
I can figure out who number two is by what's down for another request, but can we have number two differentiate which middle school this particular one is?
Grade one. Yeah, I had to check it myself.
Okay. Just, I mean, obviously we can figure it out, but if someone else is looking
at it. Are you okay to approve later, Sharon?
Oh, absolutely.
And we'll
fix
it and we'll let you
know. No, no problem.
Okay.
Yeah, it's on the request form. It just didn't make it to the revise.
Any other discussion in regards to student travel? Wonderful. To business and operations office, the consent agenda.
Yes, the one item I want to bring to your attention on the consent agenda is something we chit-chat a little bit when Steve was talking about his. On the purchases, we do have a quote for some work on the catch basins that we were talking about. One is at Anna May Birdie. The other one is out here on Panko near the Brander Center, and then the other one's on the South River. And the quote that we received was $21,500. We're going to pay that out of bond. If you have questions, Steve has nice color photos, if you want to see that. Some of them are, it's a safety hazard, some of them are pretty bad. And I know Eric's...
I'd like to expand on that. I'd like to say that this is a problem, and I'm not sure. Don alluded to the age of some of the things in South River not being very old, and I've seen another one that's not on this list that's going to be something that needs to be addressed in the near future as well. This quote, we did get other quotes, but there's a minimum code on this. I know a lot about these now. There's a minimum code on these that's a 6x8 concrete border around these storm drains, basically. And we're recommending this quote because it puts a 12x12 around it, correct? And that creates a better barrier around what is happening with these in some locations is the water is getting between the edge of the concrete barrier and the asphalt where it butts up to them. And this is something that in Don's wheelhouse from his past, I'm getting the feeling here, that and what happens is the water starts running underneath, and as that happens, you basically get something that looks like a sinkhole that's developing because the dirt, all the sand around these erodes away, and then they start to collapse inward very rapidly. So I don't know. Well, we can pass
this
the picture if you want to see it.
Oi.
This is beyond, this is,
so that's where it's eroding.
The reason I want to bring this to your attention is this is probably not the last we're going to have this discussion or you're going to see this, and we have to get a better handle on this, but these are the most critical at this time, excuse me. And they get worse very quickly if you don't deal with them.
Whoa, like Vanaway.
They get very technical.
This is Pancrow, which of course this is near the bus where all the buses come
naturally.
Out.
Naturally.
So it gets a lot of traffic.
And what that was is they were not, it looks like they built that, instead of it being concrete, it was asphalt.
Right. I was
so
going to ask about that.
Around it.
Yeah.
So we have to, and our buses go over that every day, all
so it's
day.
It's a lot of abuse.
It's very. I'm sorry. So it's something that was new to me, and I know, Mr.
Don.
During the 2005 bond, we got a very technical term in evaluating on the property because we have a lot of yucky ground around our structure. And one of the first things they did was address drainage. But the soil conditions, numerous times, when we had people go out to start the work and doing any testing, they required additional removal and replacement of materials so you wouldn't get this. So, but that's at South River is not a good indication. That's significant. And we're all dealing with lake level and the infiltration that's going on now. And that continues. So that's something that with lake level, I mean, we're not the only entity dealing with a lot of problems with that. I would expect we're going to see more. And we better be prepared. Environmental stuff is going to get you, but that at South River really is not acceptable. I don't believe there's any, you know, after 10 years, I doubt if you're going to get anything, but
right.
that's a failure.
Definitely. Sharon. I was going to address that too. I realize that there's going to be a shelf life down there, and I don't know what, is 10 a good?
No.
20 maybe?
25 is probably, you know,
and
what you're going to warranty.
And if that's, if you put the cement around it and don't do asphalt, right? Is that correct?
Well, you do a lot of infiltration. You wrap it. You do a lot of things so you don't get that.
So I was just curious, like, is any of, like, especially one that should have cement around it and doesn't, would that be on the people that put the drains in? Would that be on somebody else? Not that we can go back and do anything. I'm just curious, like, who should have been responsible for doing something different?
You may be able to go back on them.
Depending
because
on...
Because they didn't do it correctly.
The design, if it recalled for a rubber membrane and different stuff and it's not there, you might be able to prove it.
Probably what was in the specs. And if they didn't do what was in the specs, but if our specs said this was acceptable, then it's on us.
Right.
Sure. If we did...
We would have to see, like, when that was actually...
Somebody should have plans on it.
Yeah, we should check that out. The other question I had about that too, especially for the one with the bus, even with cement, are we going to have like twice as much as we should have because of the amount of weight and how often the weight goes over? What are we doing differently?
That's why, the easiest way to explain it is it's 12x13, so it's going to be 12 feet by 13 feet rather than being a 6x8.
Okay, so like 6x8 would be like a parking lot with cars would be normal?
Yes.
Okay,
and
all right.
What it's going to do is it'll displace that, you know, that tons is
okay.
Up and down You know, so it made sense to me.
Yeah.
You know, being, I don't want to say being an expert, it's an old principle.
You and Eric will become experts, right?
Yeah.
But I mean, like, this is concerning.
It is.
And it's concerning.
And the superintendent was with me the other day at one of our...
Would it be better to move it?
Ooh,
I'm asking
that
question because we may be doing this again in like 2 years or 5 years.
I think there would probably be a way that you can't, because it seemed like it was depressed down. If you could somehow maybe bring that up through some sort of extension and make it more level, but somebody...
I would ask the architect. My number one concern was that it would drain correctly, that the buses wouldn't crack it from asphalt, you know, and actually cement it and wide enough.
So it may be a good fix if we can't move it because
correct.
Right.
And it'd be,
and could we change the buses any way that they're not driving over it? No.
It's like right in front of it.
It's
dead. Right there.
I have a few questions. So how many drains are we covering in this purchase?
Three.
Okay, and how many drains do we have in the district?
Huh.
More than three? So my question is, with it being $21,500, is this something that we budgeted for?
Well, it's all bond, and we can take it out of the proceeds of... Remember, we sold the land on 23 million. We have to use those proceeds within 24 months of the sale. So we can take that out of that money.
So then will we be earmarking or allocating or planning funds for those other drains to make sure as they need to be approached we have appropriate funding in place for them?
I don't want to speak for Steve, but I know he's been doing a tour of the district and trying to get an urgent list. So if you want to speak to that.
For sure there's going to be another one at Middle School East, and I believe Middle School Central will need one as well.
Can we create a potential budget for that and announce where that's going to be coming out of, so it's not just a piecemeal approach, I think is what Hillary is maybe asking, so that we have a sort of guideline on that.
If it's bondable, that would be the most...
Well, either way, you know what I mean? So we have some scope of the next 12 months, how many we'd likely be...
So you'd like to specifically talk about catch basins.
Yes,
okay.
Correct. Okay. Is that right?
South Central is going to need something done, too. They just had cement done 2 years ago.
It's not really like one school, they're all bad. It's location based.
But I mean, when they redid the cement, because they tore everything out.
They redid those,
And they didn't bring it up or fix it.
I have not seen a problem there myself with those, but.
We'll wait for more information. Anything else on the consent agenda from anyone?
Thank you.
I do have one thing on the consent agenda. I have a question in regards to the overtime report.
Uh-huh.
So is this the last one we'll see for this year?
Yes.
Okay, so then the next one that we'll receive should have, like, the year-to-date will be all zeroed out.
Correct.
And we'll see the next, okay, so we'll be...
Yeah, we'll start with July and for when you see it in August.
Okay, so then here, I'm just looking at the top line, just looking at the top line here, we can say that custodians overtime was up by over 1,000 hours.
Correct.
Okay, for the whole year.
Correct.
Okay, perfect. All right, wonderful.
I got to say, when I looked at that, and I've looked at them enough that I should have known better, but I just kind of did a quick across the board, and I looked at it, I'm like, holy camoli, that's a whole lot. And I went, oh, yeah, that's 2018.
Correct. That's the whole year. Whole year, yes.
Versus 19 to date on the far right column.
Yes. All right, any other questions in regards to consent agenda? Wonderful. Rochelle, on to the copier contract.
Yes, so before you is a renewal for RICO copier, so just a little bit. Take it back in a little bit of history. In 2013, we purchased the RICO copying machines that we currently have, which are 79 machines. And in that was a five-year deal that included service, toner, and all the consumables, staples, and the toner on that, as well as any parts and labor. And then, if you recall, last year I came forward and we did a one-year extension for $102,000, and that was for 30 million copies, black and white copies, and that was also for service in toner and staples. So this year they came I asked them for a quote, a bid, a quote, because it's all RICO. They came back with a 15% increase, and I'm like, no, that's not going to work. So we talked, and it was a 1 year. And between talking with him, we got it down to a 5% increase, which would bring it up to $107,100, but I got a 2 year on that. Keep in mind, we're going into the seventh year of these machines, so right. I thought going 2 years, because they're starting to break down a little bit more. Mm-hmm. There were 430 service calls on the machines this past school year. So in the end of 2 years, we're going to have to decide what we're going to do, because mm-hmm. if you think the useful life of a machine, that'll be about 9 years. That's about what you're, that's really pushing. Usually it's between, I would say, 5 and 7. You can push to 9, but and they have been fairly good. At least the ones in our building have been good, but they're not like the ones at the schools that are being used all the time. So what this renewal would be is they would bill us on a semi-annual basis, so it's August and February. They will bill us $53,550. So it's an annual contract of $107,100. And then anything over the $15 million copies, there's an excess charge on that. All right, because they you know, they're saying then that you're using it more than you should. But we did go over this year, but the total overage was only about $1,500. So you didn't do that all too bad. You know, I do think the buildings control copies. I know we try to control copying as much as we can. So what I'm looking for is an approval. This is also the best deal that we have. They have a an attachment that they gave us, which is their gold deal, which is through my deal, which is from the state. A silver contract, which does only include parts and labors and supplies. But it doesn't include
toner.
Parts, like toner, that's what it was. And then the bronze was just strictly the copy image. So overall, it's a pretty good deal for 2 years. And then, again, like I said, we're going to have to figure out what we're going to do because those machines are going to start having real issues.
Could they explain to you why the gold silver deal, which is not the toner, is more than the gold deal, which is covering?
Because it was through my deal? Is that what?
Exactly.
Correct. Yes.
It's what?
Yeah, through my deal. So
it's
the
through
gold,
state bid site. That's right. Why they packaged it that way.
Because so then what they do is through my deal, more people will be using that, so they can discount it a little bit more. And then the bronze and the silver were not, and so it's just more expensive to go that way.
Okay.
Any questions from the board? Just good job on getting a 2 year mm-hmm. instead of a 1 year.
Mm-hmm.
You must run a hard bargain.
Increase on this meeting.
Yeah. So my question is where does this fall in the budget?
It's in mine.
Okay, so it's in the business department?
Yes, and then the excess we charged out to the buildings, and again, it was only $1,500 this last time. So.
Okay. And what did we budget? What did we budget for?
I budgeted for, I think maybe I had this in the back of my mind, so I either budgeted at 107 or 108.
Okay.
So.
Okay.
I budgeted based on what I had at the time.
What is? I don't remember your state function code. What's your state function code?
230.
Thank you.
I have a question.
I'm sorry, 250. This is 230,
yes. Okay. I'll be 230, you'll be 250.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Okay.
I have a question.
Sure.
When the payments come due in August and February,
uh-huh.
will they return to the agenda or will they automatically be paid if we approve? It goes now.
If you approve these now, they automatically get paid.
Okay.
Any other questions? Mm-hmm. All right. On to school loan revolving fund, please, Rochelle.
So this is approval for the application that we sent into the state. And we bring this forward every July. As you know, we pay, for our debt, we pay the interest in November 1st, and then in May we pay principal and interest. And of course, we're only levying 7 mills. So we don't really have, by the what we're levying, we always need to borrow to make the May payment. And that's what this is. Now, the reason this is so high, if you look at it, is if you recall, in 2017, we did a bond refunding or refinancing. Part of that was a 2006 bond, and it was approximately $4.7 million, if I'm not mistaken. Let me look at my number. And then we, at that time, had a large amount in the school bond loan fund, and that was over 3% interest. So we were able to refund these two. There's Series A, which is the 2006, and then Series B, which was for $91 million. And that interest rate was anywhere on a variable 2.1 to 2.3. And so the idea was that in 3 years we would go back into the school bond loan fund, but we would be saving money. So based on the projected savings, come May of 2020, we will have saved the taxpayers approximately $2.9 million by doing this deal. And so now we go back in the school bond loan fund. We will, of course, assess this. We have three big payments, so 2020, 2021, and 2022. Then we're all back in. And then, of course, at any time, if it's favorable, we'll look to see if we can do something to get a cheaper interest rate. I believe the school bond loan fund is at 3.4 right now, 4.4, if I'm not mistaken. So this is the application. Of course, we don't really go to borrow until April for the May, but we need to get this into the state by August 1st so they can then do their work by going and getting the bonds ready, because they borrow. They need to know how much is in there. So I'm looking for approval to borrow at estimated, let's see, we're looking at amount to borrow about $33.6 million.
Any discussion or questions from the board?
We borrow money to pay off bonds?
Yes.
So that we're paying double interest? We're paying interest on the money we borrow, and then we're paying interest on the bonds?
Well, you're paying interest only on the remaining amount of the bond. So like for this $28 million that's coming in here, that goes in the bond. Now that'll be in the school bond loan fund. So now it's paid off here. You're only paying on the remaining amount. So you're not really paying double interest. It's just you're using a different vehicle, debt vehicle, at this point.
It's a single percentage still.
Yes.
So the percent goes to 3.5 on this money, 3.4.
3.4 from 2.4.
No added cost beyond 3.4.
No added cost. No, there's no bond issue cost with this at all.
But our bonds have an interest rate on them.
Yes, they vary. Yes.
And so, in my mind, if I'm borrowing money from one place, I'm borrowing and paying the interest, the principal and the interest. Mm-hmm. And I'm taking that money over and paying off some of my bond, which has percentage of interest too.
Correct.
So how is that not paying interest twice?
Well, you're paying, all right, so let's, a simple example. Let's say you had a bond that was $300,000. Okay, and you didn't, and it came up that you needed to borrow the next payment's $100,000, but you didn't have it, so you're borrowing from the school bond loan fund. You're paying that $100,000 right there, so your debt goes down. So now you're only paying on that remaining debt of $200,000, and you go over here, and you've got the school bond loan fund that you're paying. Instead, I don't see that as paying double. The only other way to correct this would be to raise the debt millage rate.
Right, and so
that's what we want to do.
So we'll maintain at 7 mil.
Yes, correct.
And if we didn't do this,
19 next year,
it would be 19 mils. So, and we were obligated for this. We have no option. We have to pay.
My best understanding of it, Amy, is this was basically structured at the passage in 2005. It's the system where you pay. You levy 7 mils every single year to be consistent with your taxpayers.
Right.
It doesn't actually say you have to. You could go over, but that's a really bad situation if you have to do that. And then you pay it off by the 7 mils paying as much as possible. And then when you have a bigger bill that's due, which is next year, we have a bigger bill to do, the school bond loan fund pays off a huge amount of it in that single year. So then you pay off the school bond loan fund and get out of it. It's all amortized exactly the same way I presented it this spring. It was in there. So this was part of the plan we didn't make a decision.
We eventually have to pay off the school bond fund.
But yes, this does not extend that payment schedule from what was
correct.
Presented.
But what will eventually happen is all your other loans will be starting, the bonds will be starting to be paid off, and you're still going to be levying 7, and then you start paying off the school bond loan fund.
Okay.
Sharon? I was just going to say, are you mostly looking at the difference in the percentage rate? So you're looking at one rate and a different rate and then thinking that we're paying this and this? Is that how you're
thinking
about it?
Well, I'm figuring that we pay the school bond fund because we borrowed $1 million.
Yeah.
We pay them 3-something%. We're paying our bond, which has
a 3%.
Right.
So I'm looking at it as we're paying this.
Right.
And we're paying twice. We're paying not 3%, we're paying 6%.
I see where you're coming from, but I also completely understand what they're saying, too. So
I understand that.
Yeah. It's definitely complicated. I'm glad there's people who know how to do this.
You know, this is a discussion for the next time if we decide to do something like this, because it'll be a very healthy discussion, I'm sure, when we do.
Yeah.
But this was the way it was designed. I come to understand that there's this cyclic nature in and out of the school bond
right.
loan fund as you pay off bonds that's
right.
That I found every district uses the same mechanism right. because some years you have less due on the on your notes.
Right.
Your notes need to be paid off, and
right.
this is the one because of the fact that in 2017, right before I became superintendent, that we saved a little over a percent for 3 years on this money.
Yeah,
so if we hadn't done that, we wouldn't have come out of the school bond loan fund, and it would still be in there.
It's
right
a
now.
Better idea. It's a better
we're only
idea.
Going back
right.
in because we're paying off this
right.
amount that
right.
we've got a 3-year deal
yeah.
on.
So
that's
if it was 3 years, we would have been paying a higher rate.
Right.
Yeah. Here we save 2.9 by May of next year.
That's
right.
That's a
that's
idea.
Why it's really bigger right now because of that money
even
that's coming due from the 3 years ago.
It is complicated. When I came out of coming into public schools to see this at first, because we are just, you always pay your bonds, and it's like, you do what? So it took me a while to get used to this.
Yeah,
because
evolving.
I've never heard of that.
Yeah.
So.
Any other questions or comments regarding the loan?
No, ma'am.
All right, so banking institutions, please.
Yes, this is the annual acknowledgement of our banking and depository for investments. So on the front page, you see the banks that we do business with, Bank of America, Fifth Third, J.P. Morgan, PFM, which is MyLAF, which we have our bond, some of our bond money in, U.S. Bank, USB, UBS, ECHO, and BMO Harris. And then on the second page is those that we have been approved to do investment with, Flagstar, Huntington, Merlinch, MyLAF, Smith Barney, and the Bank of New York Mellon.
I just wanted to comment. We really are only doing regular district business on general fund with basically three banks, and then the purchasing cards on
correct.
BMO. So the rest of these are bond associated and then investment associated on page two. So
correct.
There's
the majority of our accounts are with J.P. Morgan. We do have some with Fifth Third, and our direct deposit through payroll is Bank America. And then all the rest of them are bond
related.
Right.
All right. Any questions? All right. Thank you, Rochelle.
You are welcome.
Thank
you.
On Mr. Van Camp's absence, Eric is going to go ahead and approach the Human Resources Office.
I didn't see anything that I thought was unusual on the employment recommendations. There is summer school teachers here on here that are coming after summer school started. We have worked with schools to try to do this, but they do start summer school almost immediately after school gets out. It's a very busy time of year for the high schools. So they are at, we have summer school running, and there is approval being asked for on this. So we tried to speed that up. It worked a little bit better at one of our schools this year than the other, but this is a great improvement from years past when this was much later than this. So that's the highlight I have, I think, on employment recommendations.
Mm-hmm. Any questions or concerns in regards to employment recommendations?
For
okay.
the for the staff that took the buyout, right?
Mm-hmm.
Put the right word there. I'm assuming we would have some sort of running list or spreadsheet that's telling us the difference in what we're saving between one and another.
Yes.
Or the cost difference.
Yes, the last time I sent it out, it's still accurate as far as I know.
Steps.
We'll update it once we have everyone hired this year. So once we have finished out hiring this year, we'll update it. But I think as of end of May was the last time we looked at this. I don't want to misspeak, mm-hmm. but it was 1.1 or 1.2
okay.
was the first year.
Is it on target with what you expected?
Yes.
Okay. That's good news. Thank you.
Any other questions in regards to employment recommendations? Other matters. So before we move on to other matters, I just want to remind board members of one thing that's a part of our policies in regards to our meeting procedures and in regards to the agenda. So according to our policy in section 10, item B, the president in consultation with the superintendent shall prepare and publish a written agenda prior to each regular meeting and each special meeting unless otherwise directed by the board. Individual board members may include items on the agenda by submitting them to the president. The board shall adopt or amend the agenda at the start of the meeting. So if there are board members who are requesting items be added to the agenda
Per our policy, they need to be submitted to the president. I just wanted to remind everyone of that at this time.
I've got to reread that. Wasn't there something where two board members could request, or am I wrong?
Yes, I think we did do that.
It's not in the policy.
Then that's a prior policy that was taken out of front.
Board operations or something?
I looked in board operating procedures, and adding agenda items is not mentioned in board operating procedures anywhere. I thought it was two.
When I first started on the board, and I think Amy, you were president, there was something in there about two members.
Yeah.
But now it's down to one. If you have something you want to add to the agenda, it could be added, I mean, unless the agenda is just too full,
right,
and they want to put it on a future agenda. But, I mean,
right,
I don't see why
you're saying it makes
any individual board member, so it only takes one individual board member, may include items on the agenda by submitting it to the president.
No.
So you just have to submit it to the president to have your item put on the agenda.
Okay. But we've always done that, though. We're supposed to always send it to the president.
Correct.
So it can be added.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
It just needs to be submitted to the president to be added.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
We should probably give a policy on how much we keep adding to agendas, especially special meetings or something,
right,
you know? So. Once you hit the second page, no more.
No more. You know,
please.
If you got to flip the paper over, it's too long.
That's exactly
and
right.
And I would imagine that would be as far as advanced as you know. Let's say you came in a half an hour before the meeting, you had some misunderstanding, something happened. You could say to you, Hillary, I'd like to have such and such on the agenda. And so even though that's not the intent that we would do it at the beginning of the meeting, it could be done.
Correct. It says, and the policy states, the board shall adopt or amend the agenda at the start of the meeting.
Oh, okay.
So you can always amend at the beginning of every meeting.
Right. All right. Thank you.
All right. So number one, guidelines for public notice. Is that Nikki?
Mm-hmm. So this is, by law, you have to name who you're going to put your legal notices in for the year. That's all this is. It's an annual approval that is needed from the board just to state where we're going to put our legal notices. So typically, we've always historically done Macomb Daily. That's really about it.
Right. Is there any questions or concerns from the board?
Sharon? I think I remember we had this discussion last year that, of course, the Macomb Daily, because of what it used to be. But in the age of social media and stuff, are we looking at,
go ahead.
are we looking at any legalities that we have to follow in terms of any kind of social media presence we have to do?
So far, no, but
is it coming?
For the most part, it's me that has most of the
If we had a board vacancy or a board election or something like that, that would affect our
So for, we have to do truth and budgeting hearing, and as long as it's in there, and keep in mind, there's a lot of people that have a subscription to the Macomb Daily, so they're not getting paper.
Well, I mean, in addition to versus
you're missing what Sharon's saying a little bit. Sharon is saying is, do
we
have any...
Are you advocating for more?
I think she's saying,
do we have a legal requirement
to post on social media?
I can see it coming.
Electronically or...
I think the spirit of it is to try to put it and place it in the place that most people will look for it, and since for many, many years...
Right, but that's why I'm kind of saying that, too, because historically the Macomb Daily had a lot of readership and had a lot of information. Now the Macomb Daily doesn't have as much readership and doesn't have as much information. So I'm just curious, does anyone know we're going to get to a point where we're going to have to also do social media too?
I believe it is my understanding that in Lansing before there was dialogue and conversation and expanding
there was too,
but there's been no movement or action.
I mean, I'm not saying instead of Macomb Daily, definitely yes, but it just feels like there ought to be more.
It's a good question for Troon's Law Firm seminar next spring, so put it in your notes today.
So this is to fulfill our legal requirements.
Right. No, and I'm good with that. It just keeps feeling like we still haven't made a decision on this yet. Because we should be.
Is your concern because there's not a lot of paper distribution that people get anymore? Because you have to remember, a lot of people read the Macomb Daily
online. Yes, that's true. That's true. But
it'd
part
be
of it
Macomb
is just
Daily to put it online. Then.
Yes.
Correct. Yeah. Print.
Right, but I was just thinking because in social media is online.
Right.
It just feels like I'm sort of surprised that in 2019, pushing 2020, there hasn't been any resolution maybe or a bigger robust discussion where we can come to a conclusion that says we're going to need to start doing this either in addition to, I think it would always be in addition to for quite some time before it became instead of.
The only thing I've ever heard is if you do something on social media, you just can't stop doing it. But if you're like, sometimes you don't even have to.
That's what all the kids say.
Correct.
But if you've already started, then you
can't stop. Right. Okay. Okay, good. Yep, I'm good. Thank you.
Number two, board member quarterly stipend discussion. I don't know who asked for this to be on the agenda.
I didn't.
So this is something that
I'll take it, Nikki, if you'd like. But interrupt me if I'm wrong, please.
No, it's okay. I put it on there just because I didn't want to forget. I had several board members come to me asking me questions about how the quarterly reimbursement compensation was going to work this year.
Okay.
So I, as a board, and I think we even talked about having further discussion at the last meeting.
Yeah.
So they, some people want to know, do I have to still fill in the sheets? Do I, what are we doing? Are we doing a stipend? Are we doing a monthly, quarterly reimbursement? So there's some confusion. So that's why.
Okay. Can I state that?
So it's clarification.
I believe there. You can go well beyond what I'm going to say right now, but legally, I'll just give, this is the advice I got from Trune on this issue when talking to them about something else, is that there's many things permissible with this, so it's a board decision. Mm-hmm. However, if you are, you are going to get a 1099 on this, and no matter how, whether you do it as a passive, you get it without showing, or you get it after you show, either way you're going to get a 1099.
Right.
That's irrelevant. Mm-hmm. So if you want it to count as reimbursement, then it's a, it is advice, not through the district, but the advice I received was that you would retain records, your own personal records, for your own personal taxes for that. Beyond that, there is nothing legal beyond that, you know, that. And then again, that doesn't involve the legality of the district. Our obligation is present the money accurately based on a 1099 that comes from either just a quarterly amount or from some sheets that are turned in, so it's more, you know.
In other words, keep your own sheets?
In other words, keep your own sheets for your own tax purposes. That's, that's all I was going to say, and then the rest is
so
a board decision.
Were you directed to ask that question of Truon?
No, I was not. I asked them because Nikki and I were talking about it. Nikki and I were asking that question. I just wanted to make sure the district didn't have to do anything different based on the change and moving to the quarterly piece. That's
Sharon,
all.
Then Terry.
I thought that in a prior conversation, and it may have been Truon, I'm assuming it was Truon, but they said, like you just said, a lot of different ways to handle this. Board gets to decide, but we would definitely recommend that you keep those records. But I thought when they said that too, it was for the district to have. Personally, I think that we can all keep our own personal records like we do already, right, for your personal taxes. But in terms of transparency for our citizens in the district, I personally think that there should still be something sitting here in this building that shows that you actually didn't just take this money and just go play with it, you know? Just my feeling.
Terry?
So my concern really related to if we're going to get a 1099 and where before part of it was compensation and part of it was reimbursement for mileage or conferences, now it's going to be one or the other. And you're suggesting that it's... So in other words, I don't want to unnecessarily increase... compensation that I'm going to have to end up paying taxes on.
I want to be careful about stating that this is advice coming from the district to an individual board member on what
right.
they should do with this. I was talking to him about actually some real estate questions and asked him this question because Nikki and I had been talking about it that day.
Oh.
So I was just saying it blanketly. I the detail, my detailed understanding, I did not explore further. It was a free question.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, sorry.
We like free questions.
Yeah.
Chad? I have two things. You know, we expect teachers to be accountable. I mean, everybody's accountable. This is one thing where the board, you know, indicated what they did. So basically, this negates, would potentially negate that. Yeah. There'd be no accountability for board members' participation. You could do everything, you could do nothing. I agree. I think the citizens should see, you know, or have that option of doing it. The second thing is, I worry, and there's discussion about saving money and how we do this. What I worry that we become a small club. If you can afford to be a board member,
yeah.
if you can afford the training, if you can afford to do it, yeah. and you know, with, and we've, this again, some of the proposed discussion is reducing the amount again. You have to be pretty well to do. You have to have the support structure of home. You have to have the resources, the time to do this work. I will always remember that a parent told me one time, don't forget that not everybody has the same thing that you have.
Right.
This is who we represent. Our children are not one pattern, not one set, one non-economy, whatever it is. I struggle to try to figure out how do we save money, which is critical, but how do we not make this a small group that is well supported and has the resources to do this, and so we make the decisions. Time and time again, we have these own personal perspectives in history that if we don't include if we're not inclusive, that we limit who we are because our children are so different. So I, first of all, the accountability I think is important. There's the money sided, of course, whether 1099 tax code, whatever, all those things. Those are issues that I appreciate there's paperwork to be done, but I don't think that's substantial. I did it for a while. I didn't find the problematic the amount of paperwork. It's 7 sheets a month. I didn't see that was substantial. And again, as we continue to cut education support for board members, we're becoming a smaller group, and I think the board should be concerned about that and hesitate before we make it where you have to be part of a club that doesn't have the experiences or bring everything to the table that I think the board should have.
My other concern relates to how this happened. And when we came to our budget meeting, and then there were permutations of the budget that Eric recommended, and one of them contained this, the budget related to this. This whole concept came up at that meeting. And so my issue is, when everybody was concerned with the budget, then why would we support moving from what we had to a flat rate that actually increases what the board is going to get per year with no accountability? And I think at the time, Hillary, you said you were not in favor of this. And so I just think, since the way it came up, and my understanding was from, I don't know if it was from you, but from the group, is that we would revisit and we would discuss this. When I saw this on the agenda, I thought this was our chance to discuss, because it just seems like if it was for the sake of saving money, when in reality it increased it by, I don't know, 12 or 17 or some percent, I don't know how that could be justified.
You're right. I'm not in favor of raising the money that the board gets. I'm not.
Okay.
And Sharon just left.
Oh.
Because
you want to take a quick break?
Well, we're almost done.
All right.
My suggestion would be, because I think that accepting the budget the way that we accepted the budget, I think we need to review our policies and board operating procedures in regards to board compensation. I think we need to review those because, in all honesty, I have not looked at them, but I think that there might be some interest, some conflict going on in regards to the policy and what we actually accepted in the budget. So what I was going to suggest is that the policy committee meets and review the board compensation policy and the board operating procedures and see if we do need to align things there. Now, the reason why I left, because Sharon left, is because Sharon sits on that committee.
Yeah.
So I don't want to say, hey, right. I don't think it's right to offer up work for her to do when she's not in the room.
And my second follow-up question would be to Rochelle, which is, under the I don't know, practices of the general accounting guidelines, whether it's for administrators or teachers or whatever, receipts and documentation of payment to the district, I thought was required. So the whole concept of you can just, and maybe it's just the board, you can just do a flat, but I just find that very, very interesting that we can forgo that.
Well, and this is the way I look at it, Terry, and typically you're right, you want to see receipts, but we do pay, some teachers get a stipend for additional work that they do.
Like on the Schedule B or
correct.
And so then how do you measure them? They get an evaluation, but they're performing the service. So here you're performing a service, and that's known that you're doing it. Now, you may not go to all the events and And you know, and someone that's, let's say it's a stipend for someone that had to do home visits. Maybe they didn't do as many home visits as I did, but they got the same amount.
I got
the idea is you're doing a service, and
that makes sense.
I think that's how.
That's a good. Yeah. That's a good analogy. So thank you.
So, and I think too, we also need to remember, we are not employees of the district.
Right.
So while we, I think us individually, I don't want to speak for I individually, hold myself at the same standard as an employee, I also hold myself to a higher standard than an employee. But I think we need to remember that we are not employees of this district.
Right.
Also, I think that in regards to transparency and whether or not you are actually participating, I think your face at an event speaks so much more than anything that you write down on a piece of paper.
Definitely.
So I think actually showing up and being at events and being places and being actually accessible to our students and their families speaks so much more than filling out a piece of paper.
In fact, I thought Adam did a good job of conveying that perspective when he proposed the thing at our thing, that in the end, if you're not attending anything and you're not participating in anything or whatever, then the remedy for that will be at the polls.
Correct, yes. Yeah. Also, we are not the only school district that does a flat stipend. There are other districts that do flat stipends as well. So, and there's other districts, so there clearly, there shouldn't be any legal issue in regards to receipts because there's other districts operating under that procedure.
But since this was brought up, but since this was brought up in a cost-saving budgetary discussions, and it really isn't, that's a concern.
Well, you know, I'm not.
Right.
Yes. Okay. I would like. Can we move on to three but come back to two when Sharon comes back in the room?
Yeah.
Okay. The board feels comfortable with that? Okay. So let's talk a little bit about the August meeting schedule. Being that July, it was asked of us to do the single meeting with the committee of a whole and then the voting after. It's been asked if we could do that again for August. How does the board feel about that?
I think it's fine to have one, because we're going to have a board workshop, right?
Correct. The 12th.
So we're already going to have a couple meetings.
Correct.
So
how about we just go to the 19th then, the week after?
For August meeting?
Correct. Well, what do we have? Are you keeping one we already have scheduled?
Correct.
Yeah.
So what time of the meeting?
It would be just like this one.
2:30. Yeah.
Correct. August 19th at 2:30, and then we would be canceling the August 26th meeting. We do have our summer board workshop on August 12th.
At 5, right?
That's good. 5.
Yes.
And there is also, just because it's on my calendar, the vote.
That's good.
The Lance
Creuse
Foundation vote outing is on the 15th.
Yeah, because that meeting we're canceling, that's my 35th wedding anniversary.
Congratulations.
Wouldn't want to.
All right, that's why I picked that day.
Does everyone feel comfortable with that?
The 19th, yeah.
Yes, okay.
Okay, thank you.
So we'll go ahead and proceed with that. So then we just need board member action, and we need Sharon for that. So do we want to go ahead and just take a quick 5-minute break until we get Sharon back?
26 is done, right?
Yes, 26 is done. All right, so we'll go ahead and come back at 3:55, please.
Thank you.
What part? Mr. Just
one
thing about the property.
You
know, the
1-year
hold you on Jefferson.
Correct.
Okay.
Thanks for
the help.
5 minutes.
So that
Eric's
Yeah.
It's the open space between the highway and the end of our driveway, basically.
So there's no, like, address there?
No address.
That discussion with the Little League, 51, triggered something. Scott, because he ended up being hospitalized and he has to have a transplant. Well, in trying to get everything all situated, he made several attempts to return a bunch of Little League, like a big duffel bag with some stuff in it and other stuff that still is in the trunk of his car, which, ironically, because I had a flat tire yesterday, I'm driving right now. So is there somebody that we could drop off?
I'm dropping off I'm going to Chicago tomorrow, but yeah. another coach is picking up my gear, so you can just give it to me, I'll give it to him.
Really? So, like, is the season, is this a good time to return everything?
Equipment's due back on Wednesday. So,
perfect.
Good time.
Perfect. So, should I give it to you, or should I?
I'll take it.
If you can fit it, it's...
I'll take what I can, or they'll be at the field at off of South River anytime Wednesday, 6 p.m.
Oh, really? On Wednesday?
Yeah.
Because if I give you now, I risk my giving you something that is not the Little League. So I could say to Scott, hey, look at...
This is what I'm taking back Wednesday. He said I'll be there from 6 p.m. to ? So...
6 p.m.
Chris Yackey. He's going to be the Little League president.
Who is now? He's probably...
Chris Yackey. He's going to be taking over president, I think, over Paul next year.
I took an early break.
Okay.
Okay.
He replaces Paul.
He will be.
He will.
So did everyone have a time
but
of a life on this big trip?
He's the equipment guy now, right now.
Oh, yeah.
Chris Yackey.
Yeah. Y-A-C-K-E-Y.
Yes.
Wow. But he'll be there. Tall guy with glasses.
And okay. I haven't done all of that.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that's going to be a what field?
It's off the fields off of South River.
I like the one.
Oh, you mean the one that's right there that used to be the pitching machine right across
still
that?
Is, yep.
I remember seeing that when we first got there.
Well, see, a couple times.
Some luggage didn't come with us.
Yes.
So
somebody said that they were going to meet or leave that locker open or whatever, and it never happened. So he just basically
just had it. One in Rome, he was wrong. Right.
Right
over your international airport,
right?
Right. And these were? These were some high school guys.
6 o'clock.
6 o'clock.
They were trying to find
from like 6 till 7:30-ish. Like,
okay, you will.
Like,
you
no, he will be.
He will.
I'm going to be in Chicago, so I got to drop off.
Then my French teacher came up.
Okay,
and she was like,
all right,
tall.
Sounds good.
She's from Hong Kong, and she speaks multiple languages. She walks up, she plants both feet, she leans into them, and said, you know down well, you know what they're talking about. Stop doing this to them now. Speak to them so they can understand. They are trying to do your language.
Oh, yes. Yeah. When the kids would go up to him, when the kids walked up to him, they were kind of snotty to the kids.
Aww.
To Christopher and Avery. And Chris, so, but the whole time my kids were trying to figure out how to say, I want to pet your dog. And
oh, that could be weird translating.
Right. Yeah, so one lady was like, you want to kidnap my dog? Because of the way that Chris was talking. So that turned into like the joke. But they would, Chris, they wouldn't speak English for Chris and Avery. But when I went over there and would muddle through a little bit of French, then they would.
Did you use any of the translating things on your phone?
No. And I knew he,
you know, just enough to get just enough.
Right. Yeah, I knew enough to get what we needed.
So excluding Harry Potter, because what was the best part?
No relation. We went into this cave. Sounds like it's a quarry. They projected art on the walls. So I have it was by far my favorite part.
And no hiccups with the travel at all?
Was that what?
We had a little bit here and there.
Yeah.
We kind of did end up on the side of the road changing a flat tire. That was fun.
I go from white to burnt.
Yeah. That was a good time.
Was
metric stuff, no less.
Yeah.
Oh, it was black.
Okay, so this is just like, so this is where we're driving. This inside of this is all carved out.
Yesterday, the day before yesterday, I put out.
I'm not sure I could do this. This is the road we're driving down.
That's what you told me. I'm going to make sure, because I've got a thing for my parents on another Saturday. I'm going to make sure I don't screw it up.
That's
just coming up with something on Saturday.
Okay. So never is time.
Thank you. Looking forward to it.
It's funny. Now we're complaining about not having
that's the one. And never is the other.
And it's too long. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
But then when they put the art on, look at that.
It changes everything.
It changes
I did see that
everything.
Somewhere.
This is by far my favorite. By far.
It looks like it's huge.
It is. It's huge. You know, the art's moving and everything.
Yeah,
this is a real
oh, yeah. I mean, it was really cool.
Be nice.
Before we get back into order,
yeah.
We're having a get together in my house August 17th for the board members.
Cool.
Like last year.
Oh, okay.
Don't burn your hands.
August what?
Something happened?
Yeah, she burned her. You still have the, you burned your hand.
I don't remember that.
On the grill. Isn't that the
scar? Oh, yeah.
The scar.
Water under the bridge. She's good to go.
So Adam, you already knew his number. It was all you can do at my house on the 17th.
Yeah. Cool. Well,
look what I did.
I'm putting it in right now. See what time?
Probably about 4 o'clock.
It was so nice. She and Bill are
so great. Why not, though, right? We're on the golf course. These guys roll up.
See and him relax.
Steal your clubs and we're going to hit one.
So. All right, so it's 3:56. We're going to come back in before.
One quick question.
What
time did we break?
At 3:50.
3:50. Now it's 3:56.
Yes.
Thank you.
Back to item number 2, the board member quarterly stipend discussion, Sharon. Just because you stepped out, I had made a suggestion that the policy committee meet and review the board compensation and the operating procedures to see that they are in line with what was passed at the budget.
Okay.
But I wanted, being that you're on the policy committee, I didn't want to assign you for work while you're not in the room kind of thing. So do you feel comfortable with that?
Sure. So policy and procedures mesh with what was passed.
Correct. Okay. So the 3 members of the policy committee will have to figure out a date, and we will do that prior to the August meeting.
Are there some other things you want to check in on, like... in terms of mileage and
compensation,
not that mileage and like if you want to do an individual membership or attend a conference and there's flights and stuff like that involved, if that can be written off against the 1099,
why wouldn't it be?
I just well, let's should we double check?
Just double check. He's asking to double check the policy to see. So if we wanted to go to,
because if there's some worried about it being the difference between the compensation and the
reimbursement.
So if you would like me to ask that question, I'd be happy to. If someone formulates the question to me,
we can do that. The committee can come up with. Well, yeah.
I mean, basically, what it is that if we get a 1099 for $5,000, we'll be obligated to pay taxes on all $5,000 because it would be considered compensation.
Right.
Where in reality, it might be mostly reimbursement.
Right.
So I'm not feeling that at all, and so. I don't know how we get around that.
Well, can't you write off still that mileage?
Against your 1099, yes, you can.
Your travel.
That's between you and your tax person.
I agree. That's what I'm
itemized.
Trying to clarify.
Yeah, that's if you itemize.
Yeah, that's true. It's if you itemize.
Right.
And I think it'd be a good idea if we could put the question together and have Eric ask a legitimate legal accounting opinion.
So
on
this is
how to
if please. Let's just make this right because this could have implications for people personally. So if you have the questions on this, please email them to Hillary and myself.
Okay.
Put both of us on it.
Sure.
I want to make sure that I've got all the tick marks covered on the question.
Okay.
Email it to me. Yeah. Okay.
Because your own individual concerns, I want to make sure we're
Michelle
addressed. But just for travel, let's just say they're going to go to a conference and you're getting paid quarterly, then I believe we talked about Nikki still making the arrangements. Then she would just reduce your next quarter by that versus giving you the money and then waiting for a reimbursement check.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Because I don't think she should be collecting from any of them.
No.
Right.
No.
Correct.
I think that
what
you
that,
would
Terry.
Do is that on a quarterly, and you can check that, but
let's,
it would be legitimate to,
Terry,
to handle it that way.
We need to make sure the board operating procedure is explained.
Right.
Definitely.
That method would be quite different. So
you're saying that in reality, we might get $5,000, but the 1099 form might say
$24.99. I'm thinking you could do it, but I think it's best if we double check that.
Because actually, if you check your 1099 from anything in the past, it's already like that on there. Like whatever your 1099 says, it doesn't have your reimbursable stuff. So
I know
it's
that.
Yeah.
Well, but now with the flat rate of
$5,000, so we definitely need to get some very
right.
good advice on how this is.
Did you have a question, Don?
I'm just thinking of somebody thinking of running for the board. Part of the orientation now should include this aspect of it.
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
Well, I'm pretty sure that board orientation already included an aspect of compensation.
Mm-hmm. Didn't when
yeah,
I did.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
It did when I did.
Well, I don't know how many people, some people might have the accountants or be that in tune with what this is. But we just need to make sure that anybody that's considering running for the board knows the...
easy. And yeah, we got to consider
the operation. So it might take some additional explaining.
get some answers.
And then just to reiterate, before we broke the August meeting, we are only having the one meeting.
Right.
Okay. All right, good.
Does she know the date? Between the it's the 19th, not the 26th.
The August 19th.
Because we had 2 days.
We're foregoing the 26th.
I believe I had that in there, but let me double check.
Okay.
Then Amy said everybody can go to her house for you. I heard that.
Yeah. Everybody could what?
Everybody goes to my house.
Amy invited us the 17th of August.
What time?
Say
4 o'clock.
Oh, 4 o'clock. I didn't have that. Oh, I already have a big family thing that day.
Do you?
Oh, I do.
Aw.
I guess I'll decide who I like the best at that time and decide where
I'll
go.
Right, family or friends. Where am I going?
Okay, so we're doing what the Committee of the Whole is still on the 19th.
Correct, same format
combo
as today.
Combo, like today. We're about to transition
okay.
right now.
All
right,
so I'm going to put that on there too.
Yes. Right.
Just like
everybody
we did for July.
Whatever they like to drink.
Okay. Yes. BYOB.
Yeah, BYOB. I'll take care of everything else. You bring what you like to drink. And of course, you'll have.
Okay, I'll try really hard to bring, you know, what I brought last year.
Well, I've got a bottle of it.
Okay. All right. So now we need a motion to take action.
I'll make the motion.
Wait. Hold on. One second.
You gotta put your phone down.
No, I'm putting this in there. Like, I'm canceling one and adding the other. Okay. So now we have to do
a motion to take action.
Okay. Motion for action.
And I have a motion by Mrs. Servio. Do I have any support?
Support.
I have support by Sharon. By Mrs. Ross, I'm sorry.
I'm Sharon. Whatever.
Let's roll call.
One second. Mrs. Servio.
Yes.
Mrs. Ross, yes. Dr. Spencer?
Yes.
Mr. Hubler?
Yes.
Dupe?
Yes.
And Mr. Lipsky?
Yes.
All six.
Wonderful. So now, only one item on here requires a roll call vote. Can we do that one first?
Yep.
All right.
So what is that one?
I need a motion to approve the consent agenda.
I'll make the motion.
I second.
So we have a motion by Mrs. Servio with support by Dr. Spencer. Any discussion? I need to remember to say that. Hearing none, roll call, please.
One second. Okay, Mrs. Servio.
Yes.
Dr. Spencer.
Yes.
Mr. Lipsky.
Yes.
Mr. Hubler.
Yes.
Mrs. Ross, yes. And Mrs. Dubé.
Yes.
All six.
Thank you. So next, if the board would like, we can make a motion, if I could get a motion to approve all of these items at the same time, or would the board like to go through each one and approve them individually?
I'm good with all.
All right, so if I could get a motion to approve the Hall of Distinction, student travel, school loan revolving fund, acknowledgement of our banking institutes, the copier contract, employment recommendations, and our guidelines for public notice.
I'll make the motion.
Support.
Motion by Dr. Spencer with support by Mrs. Ross. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
That was easy.
And finally, do we have any board member comments? Hearing none, do I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Support.
So I have a motion by Dr. Spencer with support by Mrs. Ross. All those in favor?
Aye.
We are adjourned at 4:04.
Good meeting, guys.
Thank you.